Hi, I'm Blair, Head of Engineering here at HeatMaster. Looking forward to part three of our video series today, where we're tying everything together, pulling in our wood gasification topic, our dual air modulation, and focusing in on combustion, how it all ties together, how we can achieve mixing, great combustion, low emissions, and optimum heat transfer. We're going to look at these topics on four different levels today, from the basic to the more advanced concepts. Our goal is to leave you well informed as to why combustion and heat transfer is important to you as a consumer. Ice cream. Have you ever made your own milkshake?
No.
No? Well, if you can imagine taking a big scoop of ice cream and you dump it into a, let's just say you've got a blender and the blender's off, but you dump your scoop of ice cream in there. What's your favorite chocolate bar?
Coffee Crisp.
Coffee Crisp. Great bar. Yeah. So you take your Coffee Crisp bar and you drop it into the blender, but the blender isn't on. Now, could you just take your straw and tap in and go? No way, right? That wouldn't make much of a milkshake. And it's sort of the same with our combustion. If we take our gases and we take the air we're bringing in with our modulating dampers, but if we don't mix them, we don't get very good combustion. Now, what would happen if you took that blender and you'd hit that on button?
It would mix together.
Mix it together. Does it do a bad job or does it do a good job of mixing?
Good job.
Good job, right? And if you leave that button on and it mixes for a little bit, then you could probably take your straw and drink your milkshake, right? Right. And that's what we're trying to do in our combustion chamber, in our furnaces. We want to take that flue gas, we want to take the oxygen from our modulating dampers, and we want to mix them together really, really well. And we want to do it in an environment that's really hot so that they burn really, really clean. And from there, once they've burnt, we want to take that heat and we want to put it into the water in the furnace where we can use it. We can use it in your house to heat your home. So that next step is called heat transfer. Now I want you to imagine if I gave you, say, a metal cup or a glass cup, and I would just get you to hold it in your bare hand, and then I would fill that cup up with really hot water. What would it be like? What would you want to do with that cup?
Dump it because it's hot.
Dump it, put it down, get rid of it somehow, right? Yeah, you don't want it to burn you. But that cup is losing lots of heat, right? Now, if I gave you that same cup, but I also gave you a big, thick winter mitt to put on, and now I asked you to hold that cup while I filled it up with hot water, would it be that big a deal?
No.
No. No, it would be no problem because the mitt is insulating the heat from getting into your hand, right? And that's part of the process that we have with our heat exchangers. When the heat exchanger has no insulation on it, it's just a nice clean tube with water around it, the heat can come through that tube just like the cup, right? But what would happen if we would cover that tube with a bunch of soot and dust and ashes? It kind of acts like insulation, right? Now, can the heat get through the insulation as easily? No, it can't. And that's something that here at HeatMaster, we take a lot of time and effort into making sure that our heat exchanger can stay really, really clean. Because a dirty heat exchanger is not an effective heat exchanger. It's hard to get the heat through. If we talk about combustion, what do you see as necessary elements for great combustion?
I mean, it's kind of like a puzzle. You need the right pieces in order to get the big picture, so to speak. So I guess you need the oxygen, you need the mixing aspect of it, and how do you bring those together to create good combustion? I guess that's really what you're trying to do, right?
Yeah, we take a lot of time at HeatMaster to make sure that mixing is happening. And we're controlling that both with our upper and lower modulating dampers to try to optimize how much wood gas we're producing, as well as how much secondary air we're introducing and mixing in with that to get really good combustion. Now, after that, air and fuel is mixed, we can ignite it, we can burn it, but what are some of the other influences that you might see during that process and throughout that combustion process that might play into how effective it all works out? What do you see as being necessary elements to keep that combustion happening at its peak performance?
Well, that would require an adequate amount of length for the gases to mix, so the path that it takes.
Yeah.
I guess if it's too short, then you're losing heat that way, but also if it's too long, either way you'd be losing some, right?
Yeah, you don't want it too long that you're adding unnecessary restriction to the combustion process, but you do want it to be long enough to allow a complete combustion. If we look at where we've been with gasification furnaces, we've found there to be huge benefits to making sure there's lots of time for the combustion process to complete. And we've extended and added to our combustion chamber to make sure that that dwell time for that combustion process allows complete combustion, that we're not extinguishing that combustion process too early. And that's something that we've, in our testing, in our development, if we vent that combustion out of our hot refractory chamber too soon, then the flames get extinguished by the cool surfaces. A water jacket is considered a cool surface to the combustion process. So that's where we've really worked with this tornado combustion chamber. We've worked with the amount of dwell time our combustion process has to work with to ensure that we get really good, complete combustion. And from there, obviously, the whole game finishes on heat exchange. If you can make wood gas and you can mix it really well and you can combust it really clean, but you don't take the heat off the process and put it where you need it, you haven't accomplished much. So when we're looking at heat transfer, we want to design a really efficient, easy to clean, easy to service heat exchanger. What are some of the factors that you see in developing a really great heat exchanger?
Well, over time, it's probably something that would maybe need to be cleaned as there's buildup in your heat exchanger.
Yeah.
You need to remove that somehow. Maybe the amount of surface area you'd have in the heat exchanger.
Mm-hmm.
I think those would all be factors that would influence your efficiency.
That's a huge factor that we're working with when we try to match a heat exchanger to a combustion process. It's a lot more than just putting some steel and some water around it and calling it good. You have to carefully balance how much heat transfer area there is, as well as considering in the future how to keep this heat transfer area effective. Any heat exchanger can be really, really effective as long as it's new and clean. But as that unit is burning and you have soot and fly ash built up on that heat exchanger, that's a really good insulator. And if you can't clean that soot and fly ash off the surface of the heat exchanger effectively, then you've lost a good amount of the potential that your furnace had when it was new. Keeping that heat transfer at its peak, even when the furnace is years old, is very important to us. And we want to see that furnace working as well in year 5 as it was in day 5. If you were burning something in a combustion environment, what types of things would you see as benefiting combustion?
Well, you're going to want to have the right exhaust, I guess. Like, have safety, so you're not going to get too hot, too cold. I guess your dampeners control all that.
Yeah, the dampers are always managing. In this case, the higher the temperature, the cleaner the burn, the cleaner the combustion. Mm-hmm. So we're not so much concerned about the top end of the temperatures, but the bottom end.
Okay.
And that comes into play even further in the combustion process if we don't keep it hot for a long enough time. The combustion needs time to complete. It doesn't happen in an instant. So
yeah.
When we send in our fuel, our gas, our wood gas, and we send in our secondary oxygen into this combustion chamber, mixing is a big thing. Oxygen in itself doesn't burn great, and straight wood gas doesn't burn great either. But you blend them properly, and now you have something that's very volatile.
Then you get a nice long complete burn.
Exactly, if you give it the right environment. If the combustion chamber is small, and the amount of time that that flue gas spends in that chamber is very, very short time, then you may not get as complete combustion as possible. But if you give that combustion time to burn, and we call it dwell time, you can burn up and have time to break down and crack those gases into combustible forms so that they can burn up completely. And you don't get any of the tars in the chimney, you don't get excess fuel being carried all the way through that combustion chamber.
So that makes your maintenance way easier then? In a
Far less, yeah, than a conventional,
yeah.
than an old school wood boiler where you had creosote running off of everything and you had chimney fires and you had...
It's always a mess.
Plugged heat exchangers, exactly. Yep. This is the upper firebox chamber where we make the wood gas is not a clean place, but that doesn't matter. As long as what's going through your combustion chamber and up through your heat exchanger is coming out clean and dry and burnt completely, then you know you've captured all the energy that was originally in that piece of wood.
And that's the problem areas for a lot of them, right? Like you have to, something that doesn't burn it completely, you're going to have plug ups, you're going to have fires, you're going to have...
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, all those things are big factors. Yeah. What kinds of issues do you see being important in a good heat exchanger? When you're looking at the final step of the process, you've made the heat, you've gasified the wood, you've mixed your gases, you've combusted well, and now we've got the final step. We want to take that heat.
Capture that.
Exactly.
I guess you guys have special metals or design. How long does that take to capture the heat before you lose it all?
It's something that's very well balanced, and depending on how much performance we're looking at achieving from the unit, we need to carefully match those heat exchangers to the combustion. If we have more combustion than we have heat exchanger, we can't take off all the heat. Mm-hmm. And if the heat exchanger is too big, we can actually have lower flue gas temperatures coming out the chimney than what we want, and you can get nasty things like condensation inside your heat exchanger. And in a wood-fired environment, that's not desirable at all.
Yeah.
You can make a lot of damage in a hurry with a condensing heat exchanger in a wood-fired environment. And if the heat exchanger isn't designed for condensation, it can be a real problem.
Really? So, what percentage do you figure you would capture of, I guess, the heat energy or the...
We want to capture as much as possible, while at the same time making sure that our heat exchanger stays clean and our chimney doesn't pose problems with condensation running, dripping out the chimneys, ice buildup. If you have a condensing chimney, it can make a real mess, and we don't want that. But the biggest factor that we find in good heat exchanger design is keeping it clean. Any kind of a heat exchanger, doesn't matter what shape it is, will work really well if it's clean. But if you can't get to all the corners easily with the heat exchanger, it will continue to build up with soot and build up with fly ash and insulate the heat from getting into the fluid around the heat exchanger.
Yeah.
As a customer, as a potential user of a system like this, how important would you see being a really simple way of cleaning that heat exchanger?
Well, that's a pretty big deal, because if you have to do it just to be safe and smart, you do it, I'm not even sure how often, because I've never had one yet, but
yeah.
As opposed to, I've seen some guys, they do it, they come out black and they're upset and everything's broken and, you know,
yeah.
Kind of ruins the day. I'm not sure, what do you guys have for easy access cleaning? Or
we try to design the heat exchanger cleaning system so that it is as easy and as fast as possible. We want to see a system that is removing as much of that insulating soot off those tubes in that heat exchanger with as little effort required from the customer. So we have an easy clean system where it's just shaking a handle once or twice a day. Would you recommend customers shake that handle a few times every time they load their furnace?
So that's just something you can do from the outside?
Yeah, no soot required. You can do it in your best clothes. You load your furnace, you shake that flue cleaner a few times, and...
Somebody was thinking.
We were trying. Nice. Yeah, we feel like it's a really effective way to maintain that heat exchanger and to extract heat reliably, even from a furnace that isn't brand new.
Yeah.
This is something that's long-term, simple to be able to use day in and day out. What have we all learned through this process about good air-fuel mixture and the environment that we want our combustion to happen in?
I would say gaining control in all of those steps, right? The more control you have, the better the outcome will be. So having started or come from previous years' units where we maybe didn't have the control we did, the control that we wanted, we feel that we have a lot better control of the overall process.
Yeah, that's something that we've never done before, is have that full floor refractory that's driving gasification corner to corner in that upper firebox, and just pulling the heat exchanger further away from the combustion process so that we can do gasification without robbing the heat from the process. We can do combustion without robbing the heat from that process. We can allow both of those processes to roll completely without robbing energy from it. Cleaning that heat exchanger, pulling that lever a few times, it takes 5 seconds, and you can see a huge change in stack temperature, because now we've removed that little bit of soot that built up over 5 or 8 hours of combustion time. And just by taking off that thin layer of soot can help improve heat transfer by a noticeable amount on a lab system where we're monitoring all those details.
That's right, and that's something the end user would never see or understand, but yet it is so important.